Currently in the Sierra Nevadas of California, we have a massive tree die-off going on. The last projection was over 100 million trees have been killed over the last year, year and a half. What's triggered that? What is different now? Why are we seeing something that we haven't seen before? So the way I look at this is you need to step back and try to figure out how the ecosystem works, how it's tied together. One of the things we've really found over the last 10 or 15 years in the Sierras, but is also pretty true for much of the drier forests in the West, is that there are two big things that really drive these forests, that really influence them, and that's fire and water. The availability of water really influences the size of trees, how many trees you can have concentrated in a particular place, their local density, as well as the type of tree that's there. The other half of that equation is fire. How does fire factor into this? Fire really controls what's going on in the understory. And the understory is the future of the forest. The trees are regenerating down there, the shrubs are down there growing and competing with the trees, and it's the fire that comes through, historically used to come through every 10 to 15 years, which would thin the forest out, kill some of the trees, kill some of the shrubs, and kind of determine who succeeds and who eventually grows up into the overstory. There is definitely a role for mechanical thinning, and there's very, very much a role for prescribed and managed fire in these systems as well. Fire is actually, under the right type of conditions, is much cheaper to use, it can be used in a much more extensive, larger area, and is very, very effective.
There's an interplay between the climate and stand density. And what we're seeing right now, really with regard to the heavy mortality related to this current drought, is not all that surprising. We've really done an inadequate job of density management. So these are things we understand. We understand that forests, if the density is managed properly, either through activity that we do or through natural means, can be very resilient.
One of the things that's really driving the stress in the forest that we've currently got is the absence of fire, which has created all sorts of small trees growing into the forest, increasing the density of the forest. And because of that increase in density, there's a real high demand on the limited resources within the ecosystem, which is water. The drought sets the event for the trees to then be killed by bark beetles. So there's an interaction going on between the bark beetle and the drought, with the drought facilitating the bark beetle by reducing the tree's vigor. Fortunately, this year in California, we've had a really abundant snowfall, really abundant rain precipitation event, which I think a lot of people believe is going to ease this problem in terms of the trees dying in the Sierra Nevadas. It's unclear whether that's really going to be the case.
There's only two ways to go, really, to address it. One is to take the approach, well, nature will handle it. Stands will regenerate naturally. And to the extent that there are still remaining trees in the area, they probably will. However, what we might see is what's called a type change. So from, say, a mixed conifer forest, which was heavy to pine, to a mixed conifer forest, which hardly has any pine, is now dominated by other species like incense cedar or Douglas fir. The other option is to plant. We know how to plant trees and we know how to get plants to regenerate. We can put ponderosa pine back on the landscape if we want to do it that way.
One of the benefits, if you will, of a massive mortality event like our recent drought kills is that if there is a genetic basis for adaptation by individual trees, either to dry or to wet, which is highly likely because our trees are so genetically diverse, then a mortality event has a much more rapid impact on the adaptation evolution of the trees. And those trees that stay alive are, if they have a genetic basis to more drought-adapted conditions, they are the ones that then become the future parents for the next forest.
It's not simple forestry. It's not the old system where you would leave the trees evenly spaced. It takes a little bit more thought to figure out where you're going to remove clumps of trees and where you're going to leave other ones. One way you can judge or get some measure of how effective your management is how many acres of forest are fuels reduced on each year, mechanically or with prescribed fire, versus how many historically had reduce fuels on them from fire when it was left unimpeded to burn through the landscape. Well, on Forest Service land in the Sierra Nevadas, that was almost 500,000 acres a year. Thinning and prescribed fire are about 35,000 acres a year. So you can see that there's a gigantic imbalance there. We really need to increase our current pace and scale by about 10 times. To do that, we're really going to have to start talking about different ways of thinking about this problem, some institutional changes, ways in which we can actually start doing treatments or putting fire out there on thousands of acres at a time. That's really one of the fundamental problems, is we really need to change the pace and scale at which we're working at.